Hey, what's up, guys? It's Kyle from RR Buildings, and I got a little bit of a special video today because I'm here with my buddy Matt. Matt?
Kyle, man, how's it going?
So I want to phrase this by like kind of letting you guys know that Matt has no idea really what I'm going to ask him.
A little nervous.
Matt, first, real quickly, like, what do you do and why would I want you to do this video with me? Because at least you know that much.
No, I do know that much. Kyle, I'm a builder down in Austin, Texas. I call myself a general contractor, so we do new builds and remodels. My kind of shtick is that I'm a building science guy.
Yep.
And I build to kind of a higher standard for efficiency and durability. I build houses that I think are going to last for long periods of time.
Right.
In fact, I built a house last year that uses a concept that the house should be around for 500 years.
Wow.
So I'm really big into efficiency and durability.
Right. So now that he said that, the biggest thing that I really wanted to reach out to Matt was, now that I've shared so much with you guys on the channel, I get a lot of feedback as far as the efficiency of a post frame, like maybe the building methods that we're using. And
yeah.
I really use the channel to try to better the industry, to make new ways of doing things. You talk about longevity, like we went from post in the ground to post on a concrete pier,
yeah.
Take away rot, like try to do it as efficient as possible with also like the sustainability.
Absolutely.
Right? Well, the next step is efficiency. Nobody yeah. wants to pay to heat their building.
Yep.
So we try to overdo it, right?
Yep.
So if you're not, you know, I know you're familiar with what we do, but yep. our post frame buildings, big sheds, they're like cavernous spaces.
Yeah,
okay?
For sure.
So
big
we try to make them tight. People want them tight. Now, if I'm gonna go ahead and tag a video because you did
airtight,
a cool,
that is, yeah, right?
You did a really good video about air tightness and whether or not a house should breathe,
mm-hmm.
right? So
get
that's
that
what really
all the time.
It piqued my interest. I wanted to know, in my business, like, are we concerned with tightness on a garage?
Mm-hmm.
Or should we, because it's a cavernous, dark space that potentially is not climate controlled, are we worried about that? Do we not, you know, do we need to think about it?
Man, that's a great question. So your buildings are different than mine in that most of my buildings are all residences and much smaller square footage, frankly, than what you're used to building.
Right.
And mine are typically air conditioned and frankly dehumidified because I'm in a hot, humid climate.
Mm-hmm.
And so really dehumidification is more important than actually the temperature. But you know, think about it this way. If you were gonna put a piano in one of your buildings, mm-hmm. how would that piano work over the next 100 years if it wasn't conditioned? The piano is going to stay dry, number one, right?
Yep.
It's going to be out of the elements. It'd probably go out of tune because your humidity levels are going to rise and fall, so you'd have to retune that piano. But other than that, a piano in the middle of one of your buildings would probably last no problem 100 years, right?
Okay.
So you got the durability down. You're shedding the rain. You're not leaking. Rain is our number one enemy. So if you take care of the rain first, that's most important.
Okay.
Right after rain, though, is air sealing. If we're really trying to build an efficient and durable building, we don't want air leaking in, because when air leaks in to a building, now this isn't so much on an unconditioned building, it's not as big a deal. You know, an unconditioned building turns out to be a, you know, a shed or a barn, right?
Right.
It's where you're keeping your animals. Your animals aren't living in an air-conditioned environment. It's not a big deal if air leaks into that environment. But if you're building a house or a residence or a conditioned space in there, a conditioned shop, let's say,
okay.
when that air leaks in, it can find a cold condensing surface potentially if your clients are
air conditioning. And I'm dealing with metal. Like all my skins are metal.
Right.
There's a lot of metal in there. Condensation is my biggest worry.
Yeah. And so what happens when water condenses on metal? Rust happens for sure. And depending on how you're insulating, you're bringing that air in potentially through your insulation if you had an air leak. And that's bad because now you maybe have some airborne insulation, especially if it's like a fiberglass insulation. You don't want that airborne in your house.
Okay.
And it might have found another condensing surface like the back of sheetrock or some other more sensitive material. And when condensation happens in the back of sheetrock, what happens?
Okay. We mold.
Right. Nothing good happens in the back of sheetrock when it condenses.
So with that being said, I get this, okay, this becomes an efficiency versus cost versus like need and want, right?
Right.
So. The next thing that is always controversial, and I know that it could be something that I need to improve upon, and that's where like I look to professionals, the guys that know more. So I house wrap all my shops.
Okay.
Because I want that air blockage.
Yep.
I don't want air penetrating. The typical post frame, it just, hey, we're gonna let it breathe. It's gonna be insulated, but the air's gonna go right through it.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't think that's doing anything for us.
Right, totally.
So I house wrap my walls, mm-hmm. but I don't house wrap the gable of the unconditioned attic space.
Okay.
So people are always like, oh, you're gonna have to worry about moisture, water. No, I don't have to worry about that. That's what my facade is for. Right. There's not a place for water to penetrate rain.
Right.
What is your take on that? Is the
smart.
Attic space need to be conditioned or need to be house wrapped?
No, because ultimately what you're doing, right, is you're building an air-conditioned, airtight box within a greater shell.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you've ever seen the photos of my hunting cabin down in South Texas that we've got, but we build a shipping container box and turn it into a hunting lodge.
Oh, cool.
And so it's a standard box size. I forget if it's a, it must be a 30-footer. So it's an 8x30 standard C-can. And we cut doors and windows into it. It's got two window rattlers on both ends. We had a leak really early on after we put it down there under our hunting property. So we built an overroof. The overroof solved that issue. Okay. And that's basically what you're doing, right? You've got an overroof, you've got your barn roof that's shedding the rain and keeping everything dry underneath it. But then you've got an airtight box that's airtight and is insulated within that.
Okay.
Do you ever get condensation or issues on your overroof?
No, because that's my main goal is proper ventilation.
Right.
I want to keep that unconditioned attic space the same as the outside.
That's right.
So nothing is condensing. Keep everything tight on the building.
Yep.
You know, I used to be a home builder. I try to treat it like a house.
Yeah.
But there's a perception that, hey man, you got to let it breathe. You've heard it a million times. And I say there's a point where you have to work smarter, not just do it to do it. And hey, I really hope you guys take what he's saying, because this guy's the professional. He knows more than a simple Midwest barn builder.
Hardly
I get it out of necessity,
hardly.
Out of need. You know,
hardly.
Like, I don't want to spend money house wrapping a gable if I don't think it's right. But it's great to hear from a guy that knows it.
I got a great analogy for you on this real quick. I'll be fast on this. But think about if you had a Yeti cooler. You know, Yeti's amazing on their marketing. You know, you see their marketing. And when I moved to Texas 10 years ago, or 15 years ago now, I had a little Igloo cooler that was $45. It held ice for maybe 24 hours, probably mm-hmm. not. Then I moved to Texas and Yeti started their company and started advertising. Now I bought a $300 cooler, but the difference is thick closed cell foam insulation,
yep.
and excellent air sealing. That lid on that Yeti, super tight. They've got like rubber straps, so it really cinches down. So that Yeti's got good insulation, but really good air sealing.
Okay.
Now if you put that Yeti in one of your barns with an overroof, how long would that ice stay cold? A long, long time.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And that's really what you're doing, is you're building a Yeti cooler that sits underneath the barn.
Okay.
Right? And your pole barn and that structure, that metal skin that's on the outside, metal lasts a long, long time as a skin. I love it. In fact, the house I built that we call the 500-year house, the perfect wall house, that has a full metal skin on the outside, and it basically has a Yeti cooler sitting on the inside. And that's really what you're building.
It's a great analogy. Wow, hey, if you guys want to learn more about Matt, because I'm telling you, he knows his stuff. He's got an awesome channel that I will tag down below. But
thanks,
dude, thanks for coming out and
really
doing this with
it,
me. So we're going to stop the comments about house wrap gable, because Matt Reisinger said,
you don't need it.
We don't need it.
You don't need it. Thanks, Kyle.
Awesome.
Appreciate
thanks.
It, guys.
Thanks.
We'll see y'all later.